This course is designed to provide marine engineers and support staff with an introduction to water treatment for steam boiler systems. It begins with an introduction to steam boilers and basic water chemistry. The course goes on to look at the problems caused by corrosion and scaling and the water treatment solutions that are available. The course examines the importance of correct chemical dosing and control and the procedures for safe sampling and testing. There is a section on monitoring water test results and a look at the tools and service that are available. At the end of the course, there is a troubleshooting guide. A steam boiler is a piece of equipment into which water can be fed. The water is heated under pressure and is continuously evaporated into steam. Steam is an excellent medium for the supply of heat and can easily be piped to the required point of use. Click on the question marks for some examples of typical uses for steam. Shell and tube boilers can be found on ships and are so called because the water is described as being on the shell side of the construction. Heat is provided by a burner firing inside a large diameter furnace tube. A series of smaller diameter tube banks above the main furnace tube provide secondary heat recovery. Because of the large diameter of the furnace tube, the maximum pressure limit of operation of shell boilers is around 20 bar. Vertical water tube boilers are the most common type of boiler found on marine vessels. They're almost exclusively used in the marine industry because of their compact construction and ease of operation. Let us look at the principle of operation. The vertical water tube boiler has a cylindrical shell and contains a hemispherical or cylindrical furnace chamber at its base. The burner is fired into this space and the hot gases produced pass around a series of tubes containing boiler water and exhaust through an internal flue to the stack. Here, the water is on the tube side of the construction. To compensate for the short retention time of hot combustion gases, water tubes can be fitted horizontally, vertically, or obliquely, cross tubes, in the furnace section to maximize heat transfer. Inside a water tube boiler, the water circulation is controlled by having a series of non-heated downcomers connecting the upper steam water chamber to the lower ring-shaped bottom header. The water in the downcomers is cooler and denser than in the hot risers, and this causes a natural circulation of the boiler water. The maximum operating pressure can be in the order of 80 bar, but is typically 10 to 30 bar. The pipework inside water tube boilers is configured to extract as much heat from the furnace area as possible. Common pipework configurations are termed O, D, and A type boilers. In a typical steam boiler system, feed water is pumped into the boiler and heat is applied from a burner system. Temperature and pressures increase according to the boiler design. Valve arrangements are used to allow steam to flow in a controlled manner from the headspace above the water level. Steam flows to the point of use and cools and condenses back to water. Condensate water is typically recovered and recycled as boiler feed water. Once the ship is underway, it is usual practice to utilize the heat rejected from the main engine exhaust gas to generate steam. This means that the boilers do not need to burn valuable fuel oil whilst at sea. Steam is raised by circulating water in a large non-fired heat exchanger. These types of boilers are referred to as exhaust gas boilers. The fired and non-fired boiler systems are usually interconnected. In general, water is never pure. Normal tap water contains a number of constituents that are important and beneficial to our constitution. The table shows that seawater has a predominance of sodium chloride with significant amounts of calcium and magnesium salts. When introduced to marine steam boilers or engine cooling systems, these constituents will cause operational problems if not removed. For example, dissolved gases such as oxygen and carbon dioxide will cause corrosion. And dissolved salts, such as calcium carbonate, will lead to scale deposition. As we will see, corrosion and scaling are serious problems if not controlled. Corrosion is an electrochemical process where metal in contact with an electrolyte, water, is oxidized to corrosion products. Local differences in chemistry, metallurgy, and oxygen concentrations will induce potential differences on the metal surface, and a cathode and anode is formed. At the anode, corrosion will take place and metal will be lost. Characteristic deposits of iron oxide rust are also formed. Broadly speaking, corrosion can be divided into two types: uniform corrosion and pitting corrosion. Click on the pictures for more information. Oxygen, chloride salts, and pH all contribute to corrosion. Corrosion in steam condensate systems can be particularly aggressive due to partially wet and hot conditions. Carbon dioxide and oxygen in the boiler feed water flash over with steam and redissolve in the condensate water. The condensate water is very pure and has no buffering capacity, so relatively small amounts of carbon dioxide will make the condensate water very acidic. Aggressive corrosion will rapidly deteriorate metal surfaces and lead to pipework failure and leaks. Specialized treatments have to be applied to inhibit condensate line corrosion. Scale deposits are formed when impurities such as calcium carbonate are allowed to enter the boiler. Due to the negative solubility properties, that is, decreasing solubility with increasing temperature, of these salts, deposition of scale is favored on hot surfaces. Scale deposits form hard and tenacious layers inside the boiler tubes. Such deposits will reduce heat transfer efficiency, cause overheating, and potential tube failure. To address the problems of scaling and corrosion, a range of water treatment chemical technologies have been developed. These are applied to adjust the properties of the feed, boiler, and condensate waters and provide protection of the system metalwork. A typical boiler treatment program consists of a combination of chemicals. In open boiler systems, it is usual practice to raise the temperature of the feed water to minimize the level of oxygen present. Oxygen scavengers are then applied to further reduce the oxygen to sub-ppm levels for best corrosion protection. There are various types of oxygen scavenger available to carry out this task, and selection of the best approach is a function of the amount of oxygen present, feed system design, economics, and any particular limitations required by the process using the steam. Some oxygen scavengers, such as DHA, hydrazine, and carbohydrazide, promote a protective iron oxide film called magnetite that further enhances corrosion protection. Steel surfaces are best protected in an alkaline environment. Alkalinity builders are used to increase pH and alkalinity to the desired levels for best corrosion protection. Alkalinity builders also help with scale control in alkali phosphate treatment programs. The alkalinity of the water also acts as a buffer, a property that will absorb pH changes if acid components are introduced and maintain an alkaline pH. In alkali phosphate treatment programs, soluble phosphate is incorporated into the treatment program to precipitate any trace hardness salts passing into the boiler and disperse the salts before they can deposit on the heat transfer surfaces. Scale dispersants are also used to ensure that any precipitated scale salts are maintained free-flowing in the boiler water. Precipitated salts are then removed by routine blowdown. This treatment approach relies on good quality pre-treatment, usually seawater evaporators. Elevated pH and free caustic alkalinity help the mechanism of precipitation. Carbon dioxide is present in most waters, and in the boiler system it will evaporate and follow the steam into the condensate system. When condensation occurs, the carbon dioxide will redissolve and lead to a low pH, which consequently causes corrosion. Neutralizing amines are volatile, alkaline materials that flash over with the steam. They combine with the condensate water to elevate pH and provide corrosion protection. Many marine steam boiler systems operate at low pressure and run at a steady state. This allows for the application and control of multifunctional treatment products, and for small and moderate-sized boilers, this is the most common treatment approach. Typical multifunctional treatments are shown here. A complete boiler treatment program can be furnished by two or three products. Where there is variable steam load, variable feed water temperature, and with high pressure boilers, Control of the selected water treatment program is best obtained by dosing product types separately. It is best practice to install chemical dosing and control systems for steam boilers. Click on the question marks to see the benefits of such a system. This chart describes how good control of water treatment applications can optimize cost and improve system protection. Water sampling and testing is used to control the performance of water treatment programs. Most treatment chemicals have a set of control parameters that should be maintained for optimum system protection. Correct sampling frequency and procedures are important to achieving consistent results. System control parameters should be in line with BS 1170 1983, Treatment of Water for Marine Boilers. Consult your water treatment technical manual for further guidance. It is important that test results are recorded, both for quality purposes and to help with the interpretation of trends. This enables corrective decisions to be made quickly and effectively. Water testing is an essential shipboard activity that should be performed on a regular basis. Waterproof is a software package developed to enable the crew on board the vessels to electronically record, store, and display results from water tests. When entering the test results, the user immediately gets notified if the results are within the set limits or if corrective actions are needed. The test results can be sent to Wilhelmsen Ships Service for review. This is done via the internet or email. A report from our water treatment experts will be returned within days after the defined test period is closed.